As we've seen technology advance, we're starting to see more and more controls shifted onto the steering wheel of a race car so that the driver can make adjustments on the fly without needing to remove their hands from the steering wheel or shift their attention. We're here at Jota Sport to check out the steering wheel fitted to their ORECA LMP2 car. Now, to start with, on the back of the steering wheel, we've got relatively conventional paddles to actuate the shift. On the left, there's a paddle for downshift, and on the right, there's a paddle for upshift. With these particular cars, once the car has started moving, the clutch is not necessary for a shift and everything's controlled via a set of ECUs. Moving to the front of the steering wheel, there's a Cosworth digital display, and this gives the driver a lot of information about what's going on with the engine. However, the reality is that under race conditions, the driver is almost never going to be focusing on any of that information. It's more important for the mechanics in the pits while the car is being warmed up, and of course, if anything goes out of a set of clearly defined limits, the dash will then display a driver warning. This brings the driver's attention to the dash, and then they can check out what the particular warning is and decide what corrective action to take. More often though, they're going to be focusing on the shift light above the driver display. This obviously tells them what the engine RPM is and when to shift gear. There are also some lights on the left and right hand side of the main shift light module that will show aspects such as indicator position and also flash when the traction control system is active. Moving down to the bottom of the steering wheel, there are two rotary switches for engine mode and engine map. Now, of course, the way these can be used is completely down to the discretion of the engine tuner. However, in this case, they're not used maybe how you would think. In general terms, these knobs aren't actually rotated unless there's an absolute reason to do so. The engine map, for example, is used to override the way the engine's being operated if there's a sense of failure. A good example of this would be that the engine normally runs in closed loop mode for the fuel delivery, where it's monitoring the air fuel ratio in the exhaust with a lambda sensor or wideband oxygen sensor. If one of those sensors fails, it can cause the engine to run really poorly, limiting the amount of power. This, of course, would be signaled to the technicians back in the pits via telemetry, and they can then tell the driver what to do with the engine map position in order to override that sensor and run in open loop mode. The mode rotary switch is similar, however, that deals with different failures that are normally not specifically related to the engine system itself. For example, there is a mode called high idle, and this can be used if there's a failure of the drive-by-wire throttle mechanism. This, as its name entails, will set the engine RPM at a high idle speed, and this can be used if the driver has no control of the throttle in order to limp the car back to the pits. It's still going to be a slow ride, but it's going to be a lot faster than if the engine was idling at its normal low idle speed. Next, we have the steering and pedal rotary knobs. In this car, it uses an electric power steering system, and the steering knob allows the driver to select the amount of assistance. This really does come down to driver preference as well as the style of track that the car is being raced at. The pedal position, very similar. This can select the translation between the driver's foot pedal position and the opening of the throttle bodies, given that the engine runs drive-by-wire throttle. Again, this is very dependent on the driver's personal preferences. However, for example, this could be used to dull down the throttle response on a wet track where traction is more of an issue. Moving up on the steering wheel, we've got two controls for the traction control system. On the left-hand side, we have a slip target, and on the right, we have a gain. Now, what this does, essentially, the slip defines how much wheel spin will be allowed before the traction control system comes into play. The gain defines how aggressively the engine control unit will try and limit slip or control that traction. Now, again, this is really dependent on how the car's set up. In LMP2, there is no ability to change the tuning on this. The engine control unit is a homologation part and can't be tuned. And it's found with the ORECA chassis that the traction control system is actually quite violent. This will again come down to driver preference, but the driver that we discussed this with actually preferred to eliminate the traction control system and do everything manually. Where this gets tricky, however, is on a wet track where with 600 horsepower only driving through the rear wheels, obviously traction can be a real issue. Looking at the buttons on the left-hand side of the steering wheel, starting at the top, we've got the radio button. Pretty self-explanatory, allows communication between the driver and the engineer back in the pits. Next to this is one of the driver's favourite buttons. This is the headlight flash button, and this is used particularly in endurance racing at night to indicate to a slower car that they're coming up behind them, get out of the way quickly. The drink button is used to actuate a pump in the car that pumps liquid into the driver's helmet. Now, this might seem a little bit overkill. However, depending on how many stints the drivers are doing, at a 24-hour race like Le Mans, the driver may be in the car for as much as 3.5 hours in one go. It's really hot in these cars, and obviously the drivers will be losing a lot of fluid with sweating, so keeping up fluid intake is really important in order to retain focus and let the driver do the best job possible. Next, we've got the P+ or page button, and this controls the page of information being displayed on the Cosworth dash. Really, this isn't a function that the driver will be using too much. More often, this is used by the mechanics or engineers in the pits while the car's being warmed up so that they can see the sort of information that is relevant to what's happening at the time. Below this is the acknowledge button or alarm acknowledge. So if a warning does come up on the dash, maybe there's been a sense of failure, this will flash up that information to the driver. However, once the driver has taken notice of this, that message can be a little distracting. So by pressing the acknowledge button, that warning will be removed off the dash. On the right-hand side of the steering wheel, at the top we've got the pit switch. This brings in a 60 km/h pit lane speed limiter, allowing the driver to go through pit lane without any risk of exceeding the pit lane limit, which obviously incurs a penalty. Next to this is the kill switch. Again, pretty self-explanatory. This just shuts down the engine. Below this is the wiper control. Again, pretty self-explanatory. There are multiple positions to control the wiper speed depending on exactly how hard it's raining. Below this is the full course yellow button, and this brings in an 80 km/h speed limit, which is used out on the track if a full course yellow is called for. Lastly, there is the power button or starter button, and this can be used by the driver to start the engine. While in comparison to a modern Formula One steering wheel, the steering wheel in this LMP2 car might seem relatively simple. All of those functions are there to simply help the driver do the best job possible while maintaining focus on driving the car.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.